you don't, if you want to not do, you said this first case.
I think I can do this. No.
You like a challenge.
Yeah. won't matter.
Well, good morning, Desert Chapel. Thank you all for coming out this morning. We got a big empty space back there. I think it's because Paul's back. He wants to keep that area clear, so don't anybody sit back in that area. Well, thanks again for coming. Several announcements. One, y'all remember a few weeks ago when we were collecting stuff for Avalon School for the start of school, right? And so now this is the time of year when Avalon School starts collecting stuff for us. They go out and get donations, and it ends up being mostly for our blessing box. So it's pretty neat when you know that you do something in the community and the community appreciates it and pays it, you know, kind of pays it forward, kind of look at it that way. And speaking of donations, we still need bedding and blankets and pillows and that sort of thing for the clothing closet. Obviously, we always need clothing. And as we head into the fall and winter, of course, we'll need that kind of stuff as well. So keep that. The September mission is collect lightly used or new blankets and pillows, sleeping bag. Oh, sleeping bags would be great as well, right? Okay, so good. No more winter clothes? No more women's clothes. Okay, so you women, your wardrobe is safe for a few more weeks until it goes the other way, and then we need more women's clothes, right? Okay. All right, and Pastor has said, and I know this is a problem, if you're calling into the office and you get the answering machine, our answering machine is not the best in the world, and it's very difficult to understand, especially phone numbers. So if you're calling in and leave a message, leave it as clearly as possible. Leave the phone number a couple of times and make sure you relate that to a name so that we can return those calls. In the back, speaking of plenty, we have sweet corn and we have kneader's bread. So I know several people already have their eye on the sweet corn. So we want to clear a path when you're headed out later on back there. So yeah, please take that. That's left over from a community feast that we have, and it's all fresh. In fact, I saw Nancy in, what was that, the name of that place where we, yeah, the market there on Apache Trail. I saw her in there carrying out a whole case of it, so. All right, Pastor, do you have anything to add? No? Okay. Michael. Birthdays and anniversaries? Well, that's still you, too. You've got to play the thing, right? Okay, who has a birthday? What month is it? September? Who has a September birthday? Way in the back, up here. Anybody know anyone that has a September birthday? All right, somebody there. So we're going to sing Happy Birthday. Anniversaries? Oh, wow, several. Look at all that. All right, did everybody see whose anniversary it is? Okay, not mine, I'll put my hand down. Congratulations to all the birthdays and anniversaries. Okay, Michael, if you'll lead us into our worship service now, thank you.
Thank you, Michael. If you're comfortable standing, would you do so for the call to worship? Followers of Christ, God calls us as we are to live as truth tellers and gospel bringers in the world. God, we know you call us, and still we ask, who am I that you would call me? Like Moses standing before the burning bush, convinced of his unworthiness to lead your people out of bondage, we ask, who am I that you would call me? Like Peter, who thought he got it right, only to realize that who Jesus is doesn't meet his expectations of who a Savior should be, we ask, who am I that you would call me? As we raise this question to God today, we open our hearts to receive God's answer. You are my beloved children. You are my disciples. You are my people, called to share the love of God for the transformation of the world. And the hymn to follow in the small hymnal, number 2087. 2087.
Please be seated. Well, good morning, Desert Chapel. We are a praying church, and today we came into this sanctuary, either virtually or physically today. We came in with our joys and our concerns and our prayers for others and our prayers for ourselves. And today is Lord's Day, and we have our opportunity to lift them up to God and to join as a community together in prayer for help. There are multiple ways that you should and could be getting your prayer request in, because we are a praying congregation. I know I say this every Sunday, but I want to encourage you to join in the community of prayer as we are a loving people who pray together. First of all is Prayer Bear, of course, on Sundays, which we have two things in. Thank you for that. So yes, Prayer Bear is real, and he wasn't lonely today. So always before service, if you want to put a prayer request in there. You can also fill out the prayer request card that's in the back of the pew and drop that into the communion, and make sure that you're on our email list, as we have our prayer chain amongst all of us that we can share. You can also email into the office at info@desertchapelumc.org. Hint, if you email in, then that won't be a garbled message, right? We'll understand that. And certainly an opportunity is also calling the office, but as our lay leader Dave said, please enunciate and feel free to repeat that a couple times, as we want to be responding to you. All right, so in today's prayers, we continue to lift up Greta Federico as she continues to recover from shoulder surgery. We are anticipating the day when we see Greta's smiling face back with us here in the sanctuary. We also need to share that Artis Gustafson, who, as you know, is always faithful in that middle pew right there, Artis was taken in to the hospital yesterday by her daughter. So we are praying that she is released on schedule today. There were some possible hydration issues. And let us make sure we lift up Artis in prayer. We want to see her back as soon as possible. We continue to lift up the little 9-year-old boy, Sebastian. We have some updates. He had a central line placed in his chest for the chemo that he is going to be receiving for that cancer. The chemo is going to be starting on Tuesday, and the bone marrow transplant will be on September 13th. So far things are going well, but let us continue to lift up that little boy who is facing such extraordinary challenges. We also are lifting up Jim Bryce, who is suffering from ALS. Let us lift him up in prayer and his loved ones. We're lifting up a dear friend who is also having medical problems today. We are lifting up Lori Wilburn, who's the daughter of Jim Edwards. Lori continues to battle stage 4 non-smoker lung cancer and is having challenges throughout the body. Let us lift up Lori as well. Today we continue to lift up those on the Hawaiian island of Maui as they continue to assess the deaths and losses from that horrible wildfire. That's going to take many years for recovery. And we are in hurricane season, and Hurricane Idalia went through the Florida Peninsula, and there was a great amount of flooding. So let us lift up those folks who are digging out and tearing out carpet and assessing those damages and losses. If you would, please bow your heads and join me in a moment of prayer. Almighty Lord, loving God, we come to you today in friendship and fellowship and community to worship you. We come to you today to lift up to you those things which are too heavy for us to hold. We know that your strength is eternal and that you will handle them. Sometimes we need strength, as the weight of the world seems too heavy for us. We lift up those concerns and fears to you. We continue to lift up those, Lord, that do not have air conditioning or do not have adequate cooling in this continued heat wave. We thank you for the rain that you brought to the landscape and nourishes and quenches the thirst. Lord, we lift up those who couldn't be with us today, those who are ill, those who are in care centers, hospitals, hospice. We know that you're with them, and we want them to feel as we are with them as well. So lift up peace around them and bring them home. Lord, we walked into the sanctuary with joys as well for new relationships and friendships and opportunities, visitors and guests. We thank you for all of that. We thank you for the bounty that you place in front of us. And now let us, as a community of Christ, lift up silently in prayer those things in our hearts that we brought with us right now. Lord, thank you for this opportunity that you give us every day to be with you, to be with our friends and family, to be here together. And now, as confident children of Christ, let us join together and say our prayers of the people. Lord of summer sunshine and autumn harvest, be with us this day as we gather to encounter your word and your way for us. Remind us that we can place our trust in your eternal love. Enable us to be more effective in our witness to that love by word and deed. Guide our steps and pick us up when we falter. Dust us off and place us on the pathways of grace and service. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Scripture reading this morning is from Exodus 3:1-15. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. He led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I'll go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, Here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for this place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. At this, Moses had hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers. I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land in good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go, I'm sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they ask me, what is your name? Or what is his name, excuse me. Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am, you sent me to you. God also said to Moses, so to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name you shall call me from generation to generation. And the hymn to follow, if you're comfortable standing, please do so. Be Thou My Vision in the regular hymnal 451.
Please be seated. Have you ever been called to do something you didn't want to do? You ever been in the right place, the right time? Or maybe you were in the wrong place at the wrong time, but you felt morally compelled to do something that you knew was going to be difficult. It was going to take time, effort, and might even cost you some money. On March 27th, 2013, this was Easter Sunday. I can always remember what day Easter was on 2013. Our backyard was overgrown. It had been a wet spring and our lawnmower wasn't working. But I was out in the backyard trying to get ready and hide Easter eggs for the children. They were still young enough to enjoy the challenge, and the yard being overgrown was an added benefit because there were more places for hiding. But it was getting harder and harder to trick them. So as I walked around the backyard, I noticed something very colorful in the grass. And upon closer inspection, it was a mother cat with a litter of kittens. It wasn't quite the Easter surprise I was looking for, but nonetheless, it was a birth, and she'd made a bed hiding in the tall grass of my backyard. Now, we've always been a cat family, and my sister's a veterinarian, so I knew not to disturb them. So I very carefully backed away, and we planned our Easter around the remainder of the backyard. But we never forgot about those kittens, and so the next day we went and checked on them. And all we found was one very tiny little newborn kitten alone shivering in the cold morning. Now I had no idea what to do, so we picked her up and we wrapped her in a blanket and immediately called my sister for help. She said the newborn without its mother only had a 50-50 chance of survival, and that little tiny kitten would need much the same care that a newborn human does, warming and bottle feeding and pretty much constant care. So this was not something that I'd planned on doing that spring. And my wife and I both worked outside the home and the children went to school. So I didn't ask to have this task. I didn't ask to save this little helpless life. It didn't come at a particularly easy time for our family. And yet walking away and letting it perish in the backyard alone in the cold, it seemed equally impossible. So for the first few months of the kitten's life, we enlisted all kinds of help. The church office took care of her during the day. They even passed her around a grief support group so she could be held and kept warm. We understand that it helped the grief group too. So we took her to Wednesday night dinners, and we lost a lot of sleep. We fed her throughout the night. But the story has a happy ending because that little kitty is a very healthy and feisty 10-year-old cat right now. But sometimes we're just in the right place at the right time. And sometimes we're in the wrong place at the right time. But we are compelled, we are called to do the right thing. Our text today is very famous. We are in the second book of the Bible, the book of Exodus, the Old Testament. Today we hear about how Moses was called and commissioned by God. He was not looking for this opportunity. He was not expecting it. And he was reluctant to take it, despite being called directly by name by God. The book of Moses is the second book of the Bible. It's one of the five books of Moses, also known as the Torah in the Hebrew Bible, or the Pentateuch by Christians. Pente means five in Greek, and those first five books are Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. But the book of Exodus lays the faith foundation for the entire Old Testament. The scriptures we read in the Old Testament set the stage and the foundation for Jesus and our scriptures in the New Testament. The events of Exodus are believed to have taken place around 3,300 years ago. And although there is debate among theologians and historians about exactly when Exodus happened and which Egyptian dynasty it took place under, the important parts of Moses are not in dispute. In the first book of the Bible, in Genesis, the story of Joseph shows us how the Israelites came to Egypt. But by the time the book of Exodus starts, the Egyptians have enslaved the Israelites. The Israelites have grown in number to a point that that's frightened the Pharaoh of Egypt. So the Pharaoh is scared of his slaves outnumbering the Egyptians, and he orders all Hebrew newborn males to be murdered. Instead of murdering them, the midwives put the Hebrew baby Moses into a basket and stuck him in the Nile River, where he's found by a member of the royal household of Pharaoh. The woman who adopted Moses, who pulled him out of the Nile River, was Pharaoh's daughter. So Moses, the Hebrew baby who had escaped death, was raised as an Egyptian prince. He had wealth, he had status, and he had the best education the kingdom of Egypt offered. Now, theologians and historians believe that Moses did know that he was Hebrew, or in around the age of 40, they believe, he saw an Egyptian taskmaster torturing a Hebrew woman. Moses killed the Egyptian, and he protected the Hebrew woman. His crime was quickly discovered, and Moses fled Egypt. He fled and left everything he knew. He left behind wealth and power, and he ran into the merciless Sinai desert. He eventually meets a tribal leader of a Midianite tribe. The Midianites were cousins to the Israelites, and the tribal leader gave him shelter and a job, and Moses married one of his daughters, Zipporah. So after 40 years of being a prince in Egypt, Moses then spends the next 40 years as a shepherd in the desert of Sinai, tending flock and raising two children. He spent 40 years doing that. So if you do the math, that means by the time our scripture chart starts in chapter 3, Moses is 80 years old. He's still tending sheep in the barren landscape of the Sinai desert when he sees a bush burning. It's not being consumed by the fire. But Moses also hears his name being called, so he approaches the burning bush. God lets him get close, but he stops him short, telling him to remove his sandals because he's on holy ground. God calls Moses by name and tells Moses that he has seen and heard the cries of the Israelites. He knows the suffering of his children who have been slaves in Egypt. And God is sending Moses to lead his people out of oppression and slavery. God is sending an 80-year-old shepherd who was once an Egyptian but now a fugitive to go and present God's demands to the Pharaoh of Egypt. God is sending Moses to take Pharaoh's workforce away so that they, the Israelites, may gather in the desert and worship God and receive God's commands. Now, not surprisingly, Moses responds with, "What? Who? Me? Who am I to do this?" We can relate to that, right? God says, "I will be with you. Get going." Moses pushes back again. He says, "If I just stroll up to the Israelite populations and tell them to follow me into the desert, who should I say sent me?" It seems like a rational question. The Jewish population in Egypt didn't know Moses. So God says to Moses, "I am who I am. That is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you." God also said to Moses, "Say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name you shall call me from generation to generation." Because to know someone by name, to call someone by name is in Jewish culture was important. God called Moses by name. And now God tells Moses to know God by name and declare that to the Jewish people. "I am who I am." To know God's name is to know the character and nature of God. Now, if this were a Marvel superhero movie, this would be an origin story. The book of Exodus is a long and it's challenging and it's a sometimes difficult read, but it is oh so important to the foundation and teachings of God. Exodus gives us a theology that God lays down in the Old Testament. Now, in the last few weeks here, we've been in the Gospel of Matthew in the New Testament. And Matthew's focus was connecting his Jewish audience's Old Testament background with Jesus' preachings and teachings. So there's a lot revealed in Exodus that connects those dots. All right, so this is now, we need to address the elephant in the room right now. The 1956 movie by Cecil B. DeMille, right? Called The Ten Commandments, starring Charlton Heston and many other A-list actors. So that movie played in my house every year growing up. That movie played in Ernestine's house every year growing up. And not shockingly, it now plays in my house every year. So I'm here to confess that until I started on the path to ministry, that most of my life, I believed that Moses probably talked and looked like Charlton Heston. If your vision and understanding of the story of Moses in the book of Exodus came from the 1956 film, please do not feel guilty or bad. For the most part, that film follows the scriptures. But did I mention that Moses was 80 years old when he was called by God? Moses is much more reluctant than the movie portrays. In chapter 10, verse 10, Moses tells the Lord that he is not a good public speaker. He is not eloquent. In fact, some theologians interpret the text to mean that Moses may have had a stutter or a speech impediment. Moses may have been well-educated, but he was not a Shakespearean-trained actor and orator. In his final and most dramatic push, back in chapter 4, verse 13, he says what would have been on many people's hearts. Lord, can you just send someone else? Lord, just please send someone else. Don't ask me to do this. But God did not accept no for an answer from Moses, and the rest is history. Has he ever accepted no from you? How many times have you felt the calling of God on your heart? How many times have you ignored it, only to be nudged multiple times later and say yes? The Reverend Adam Hamilton calls Moses the reluctant prophet in his book. Once a prince, then a shepherd, and now called to be an ambassador, a prophet, and a leader of a nation. Now, I absolutely love this passage of Scripture in the Old Testament. There are three big things that I love about this passage. First, it reminds me of the movie that was formative in my childhood. And yes, I know it's not entirely scripturally accurate, but it was a powerful and a moving film. And once you see it, you'll never forget it. Number two, it is rich in theology and history. Exodus gives us not only the deliverance story of the Jewish people out of bondage, but also Exodus gives us the foundational laws of Judaic society. The tradition, the laws, the cultural foundations that carry through the Old Testament and eventually bring us to the Gospels when Jesus gives us the New Covenant. I think to understand the Gospels, you need to understand the First Covenant. You need to understand what Moses received from God and what Moses gave to these people as a foundation of their society and their faith. And third, it is the quintessential commission and call story. Moses doubts, Moses pushes back, and then Moses follows God. His story of receiving the call and doubting and pushing back is so very human and relatable. Now, every person who's ever been called into ministry, whether it's to be a certified lay minister or pastoral, the very first thing you have to do is to write your call story. You have to define that burning bush moment that occurred in your life. Now, few people actually encounter a burning bush with God calling us by name, directly like Moses. The majority of us encounter our call moments through other people as God's instruments and tools. Now, for me, over 10 years ago, I was preparing for Scout Sunday worship service in February. I went to see our senior pastor to work with him to plan out the somewhat unique worship service that we did every year. It involved a lot of young people. This wasn't new. I'd done it before, but this year was to be different. The Reverend Michael Brandt, who's now a friend and a mentor, he looked over at me and he said, "Why don't you preach?" See, it wasn't really a question, it was a statement. He said, "You should preach. I'm calling you. Get going." I don't really remember the rest of that conversation, because I probably just stared at him with my mouth open and fumbled around some words, and I left that office as pretty quickly as I could. My next stop was down the hallway to talk to our associate pastor, Eve Williams, in whose office I sat dumbfounded and said, "Can you believe what he just asked me to do? I'm not worthy of this. How could he have asked me to preach?" I don't remember the details of the conversation, but I do think Moses' name came up. God will be with you. It will be okay. Get going. And I did preach that Sunday, and everyone survived. And after that, I started to feel the nudgings from God to pursue ministry. Now, for me, it took me a lot longer than it took Moses to bring the Israelites out of bondage for me to move into ministry. But I did follow the call. Now, it's easy when you hear a call story from a pastor to think, "Well, that's not me. I'm not called to preach. I'm just a liturgist, a communion server, congregational care leader, or coffee hour organizer. I'm just something else and surely couldn't have gifts for ministry." So let's clarify that right now. Right here, you are never just something. We all have God-given gifts and graces for ministry. We are all important, and we all have a calling to answer. The Apostle Paul says it best in his letter to the Ephesians in chapter 4. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. So when I hear someone say they're just something, I usually intervene. Our liturgists deliver the word of God on Sunday morning. Our communion stewards serve at God's holy table for the great Thanksgiving. A congregational care leader sits with those who are sick in hospitals and holds their hands. Our hospitality people deliver smiles and welcomes to people who might not otherwise feel welcome. I can think of no greater mission in ministry and no one being more important or less important than anyone else. There are many more examples of people using their gifts in God's work. I encourage everyone who can attend the lay servant ministries classes that we are scheduling here for late October. You'll say, what is lay servant ministries? Well, simply put, they are programs by the Methodist Church to help everyone discover their gifts and where to use them. And notice I said discover them, not tell them their gifts, but discover them. Because sometimes we have to quiet out the world around us to listen to God. We have to have that intentional time of prayer and reflection to listen to what we're being asked to do. It's a noisy world out there. Not everyone will experience a burning bush in the desert, and yet every one of God's children has been given gifts and graces. Not just some, but all. It's easy to be depressed or discouraged when we read the news about a decreasing rate of volunteerism and a decreasing rate of people in ministry. There's no shortage of need out there, as we see every Saturday right here with a feast. There is hope in what we read about the younger generations wanting to do ministry and be active. They may be reluctant to sit through an hour of church, but they are ready to do. And that's a start, and that's hopeful. So we all must change our mindsets to recognize that Jesus taught us in the Gospels that we are all cornerstones of the church and that everyone has been given gifts. So start by admitting that you have gifts, even if you don't know what they are. Be engaged and take advantage of the small group or the class offerings that help you discern those gifts and recognize that there may be many, many ways to serve in ministry that don't have to do with public speaking. In the Old Testament, God called shepherds like Moses and David to change the world. In the New Testament, Jesus recruited poor fishermen, tax collectors, and sinners to be his disciples. There are moments when God has done dramatic things, such as part the Red Sea. But more often, God uses simple people like us, ordinary humans, to be his instruments of mission and change. That's hopeful. That's encouraging. In today's text, we see God call and commission an 80-year-old man to lead an entire nation out of oppression and slavery and to forge a new covenant with the people. He was reluctant. He doubted. Push back. At each point, God said, get going. I'm calling you. So what is your call? How are you discerning it? If you haven't figured out that call, what are you doing to figure it out? Because regardless of your age or what your gifts are, God's words to you are the same as they were 3,000 years ago. Get going. I'm calling you. And all of God's children said, amen. Amen. I would invite our ushers to come forward now to receive our tithes and our offerings. Thank you. Almighty Lord, we ask for blessings upon these gifts. We ask for blessings upon the givers and those who are unable to give. And we ask that you use them and us to be the cornerstones of your church and community on earth. We ask all of this in your name. Amen. Please be seated. Today is the day that the Lord has made for us. Today is also a glorious day, as it is an opportunity for us to celebrate the great Thanksgiving, to partake in Holy Communion. I invite you to follow along in the communion liturgy. It'll be on your slides. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you. Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, you formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who looked for that day when justice shall roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. When nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and spirit. At his ascension, you exalted him to sit and reign with you at your right hand. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry for all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as a community of Christ, let us join together and pray the prayer that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'd invite those helping with communion to please come forward. This is God's table. This is the Lord's table, and all are welcome here. In the Methodist Church, we use grape juice instead of wine so that all may partake in the Holy Communion. We will have regular bread, and we will have the grape juice. We also have, if you prefer, the self-contained that we've been doing for the past couple years. Al will be having have that tray for you if you prefer that. And if you need to be served at your seat, please raise your hand and Mr. Edwards will come to you. Today is the day the Lord made. Come, eat, the table is prepared. Thank you. Let us now, as a community of Christ, come together and in unison say the prayer after communion. God of love and mercy, be with us this day. We have faltered in our service to you. We create divisions between various people. We judge before we listen. We condemn before we make any attempt to understand. Our lives are in turmoil, and we confess that we have turned away from you. It is fear and anger that too often surrounds us, and our actions become based on those fears and anger. Slow us down, Lord. Give us hearts overflowing with grace and compassion. Help us to mirror Jesus, who loved and healed others who were rejected by polite society. Remind us that we are called to be strong voices of hope for those who feel alienated and lost. We are called to be a home to strangers, to quench thirst, to give nourishment, to welcome, bring words of hope. Forgive us when we have forgotten these things. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Our final hymn today is On Eagle's Wings. The words are on the screens. This should bring back lots of memories for everyone.
Three-day weekend. It's still hot, so what do we want you to do next Sunday? Come back safe and alive and hydrated. So continue to drink lots of water and be safe and stay in the cool. Enjoy that 3-day weekend. We do have a date as of last night. The last Friday and Saturday of October will be our Lay Servant Ministries classes held right here at Desert Chapel. So tying right in there, all of you have gifts. We'll tell you how to sign up, come out and explore them, because each one of you is blessed. Each one of you have God-given gifts. And as you go out into that beautiful Arizona Labor Day weekend, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his countenance to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and bring you peace. Go forth. Amen.